Hi everybody, this is Dr. A. We're going to start a little series on lab safety. So very basic stuff here, but very important also. All right, we're going to start the series with patient safety. So 98% of the errors in the diagnostic process do occur in the pre-analytic phase. So what is the pre-analytic phase? It's the phase from order entry through specimen collection and processing up till the testing phase. So the testing phase starts the analytical phase of the diagnostic process. So the two main areas of concern for patient safety are communication and then mitigating patient risk. So communication involves reporting errors that occur. So self-reporting is best, but reporting has to occur for patient safety to be a priority. And so this could be something as simple as samples that were mislabeled, wrong patient that was stuck, wrong tubes that were collected for a specific test. It's really best to report these things and not just pretend it didn't happen and just have a do-over and nobody knows about it, okay? So one, you want to report errors for quick resolutions of the problem. So you want the, you know, if the patient needs to be restuck, you want that to happen right away so there's no, you know, or minimum delay in testing. If it's an error where, for example, the wrong test got reported out, and it's the wrong result. Maybe something got reported out as positive instead of negative, and it's already made it to the chart. Then you need to notify that right away because that erroneous result, especially if there's a paper printout or something like that, needs to be pulled and obviously corrected in the system right away. And it needs to be notified and documented and, you know, all of those things so that we can see what's going on. And so, and one of the reasons why this is important, so this is not really about assigning blame and, you know, places to have a culture of patient safety, what they want to know is, you know, how are the protocols and practices of the lab, are they being followed? Yes, but sometimes there are problems within the protocols and practices that need to be addressed. And the idea here is to find patterns that could cause, you know, others to commit the same error. And sometimes it could show that maybe the lab is understaffed and that's why there are some mistakes that are happening, is because everybody's rushed. But if you don't report those, then there's no identification of the problems that are going on, and then you're not going to get a resolution and solution to that problem. And then mitigating patient risks, meaning decreasing the risk to the patient, involves, you know, obviously identifying some situations that are going to be high risk for patient safety. And one of the big ones is being prepared for IT outages, whether they are planned or unplanned. Because we are heavily reliant on technology, everything is done through computers, from order entry to specimen processing to resulting and all that. If the system is down, then you have to do everything manually. So orders would have to be called in or written on a handwritten order. You don't have all the identifiers, or you have to find ways to get the identifiers to properly identify the patient. Results would have to be called and documented that you talk to nurse so-and-so or doctor so-and-so. And so there's a whole protocol that needs to be put in place so that nothing falls through the cracks and so that patient safety can be maintained as much as possible during this time where there is a high risk for errors to occur. So the Joint Commission has put out some national patient safety goals back in 2017, and the first one was to correctly identify a patient by using the patient's name and birth date. Now, this has been in place for a lot longer than that, but those are the two accepted identifiers. And I must say here, the best practice is going to be for the lab tech or the phlebotomist to, one, identify themselves and tell the patient where they're from, that, as in, we're from the lab, we're here to draw some blood or draw a specimen. And then ask the patient to tell you, or tell, you know, the lab tech, their name and date of birth. So elicit the information from the patient themselves. It is better for it to be that way than for you to come in and say, hey, this is so-and-so from the lab. Are you Mr. or Mrs. such-and-such, whatever date of birth? Because if you have a patient that has dementia or has altered mental status, they may say yes and agree when that's not who they are. And so it is much better for you to ask that information from them. Now, if they can't provide you that information, then you have to then resort to identify them maybe with their armband information, or if the patient's a pediatric patient, you can ask to pay the patient's parents, so the whoever the caregiver that's there, to identify the pediatric patient by telling them their name and date of birth. Okay, so the next goal there was to improve staff communication to ensure that important test results are getting to the right staff person on time. And so this is very critical. If there is a critical result on a patient that needs intervention right then and there, it is really important to take the extra time to track down the right nurse, usually, or doctor that is caring for that patient, and to document and talk to the person that's taking care of the patient and making sure that they get the results, that they read you the results back so that they understand what you told them, and that you document who you talk to. And the problem would be, like, if you call it to a unit secretary and they took it down and then they failed to communicate those to the nurse because they got busy or something else happened, then you know, your patient's going to be sitting there with some critical results and needing intervention and nothing happens, and it delays patient care. And then, of course, we want to prevent infections by using the CDC and WHO guidelines, and this is this can go both ways. We definitely want to make sure that we are not infecting our patients. So, like, if a phlebotomist or a lab tech went to draw a specimen in a room from a patient that had a highly infectious, highly communicable disease, something that spread easily, and then they didn't follow the proper protocols, they risk, of course, taking that infection to the next patient that they're sticking in, and the next patient, and then that infection could spread throughout the hospital. There are six goals of the U.S. Institute of Medicine for healthcare delivery regarding patient safety. So they are safety, timeliness, effectiveness, efficiency, equitable treatment, and patient-centered focus. So safety, again, refers to what we just talked about, making sure that we are not causing adverse outcomes to the patient, that we're not harming the patient, etc. Timeliness has to do with doing the tests that are ordered on time, but also the tests being ordered for the right time. And so if it's a stat order, something has to be done right away, timeliness dictates that, you know, that specimen should be drawn and back in the lab likely within 30 minutes to an hour. If it takes 3 to 4 hours to get that specimen drawn and back in the lab, it's a timeliness issue if the test was needed right away. Effectiveness has to do with ordering the right test for that patient. And so sometimes that's recognizing on the lab tech side where maybe they ordered the wrong test, that is, whatever they order is not matching up what's going on with the patient. So sometimes you can, you know, talk to the physician, make sure they actually ordered the right test, or maybe suggest a test that needs to be ordered. And then efficiency has to do with not, like, overdoing it. So with ordering what the patient needs and not wasting lab resources and time. So physicians have a tendency to order a huge battery of tests, kind of what we call the shotgun approach, where just peppering the thing with a bunch of different tests and just seeing what sticks, seeing what is going to come out. And that's not a very efficient use of lab testing, because that's cost that we're maybe a lot of the tests that were ordered were not necessary at all. And then equitable treatment has to do with treating patients the same, regardless of, you know, gender, social status, race, skin color, any other factor that could be where, you know, the patient could feel discriminated against, for sure. Just like, for example, using gender as an example, it's possible, for example, for older physicians that are male to look at female patients and just think, oh, they're just hypochondriac, they're just overdoing it, they're just being dramatic, and not taking them seriously, and then therefore then not ordering the proper test to get to the concern of the patient. So equitable treatment says that if you come in with signs and symptoms that are XYZ, you get such and such testing regardless of who you are, right? That would be equitable treatment. And then patient-centered focus is just remembering that, you know, we're here to take care of the patient. We're here to help the patient. We're not here to generate, you know, profit for the hospital or the lab, or to order as many tests as possible so we can increase our revenue. We're here to take care of the patient and do it in a safe manner. And then our last slide is going to be over the American Society for Clinical Lab Sciences patient safety indicators. So they break them down into the three phases of testing: pre-analytical, analytical, and post-analytical. So pre-analytical phase, as we've already said, starts with order entry and goes through patient identification, specimen collecting, specimen processing, and all the way up to the analytical phase. And so in that phase, it is important to have proper patient identification. So, you know, not using their name and date of birth to identify them, sticking the wrong patient, even potentially mislabeling specimens could be an issue with patient identification. Phlebotomy-associated negative events, this can be anything from really excessively sticking a patient. The rule of thumb for phlebotomy is most patients and most facilities will allow you a miss. So you can, if you go in, stick a patient and miss, they'll allow you to do it again. But then if you miss again, you need to go get somebody else if that's possible. Things you also want to watch out for is not causing injury when you put band-aids or take band-aids off, not ripping their skin, etc., and then not leaving needles in the bed. So that's a problem sometimes if a patient's bedbound and you know, they can move around, and needles sometimes can get jabbed or jammed underneath the patient. That can cause bed sores and injury to the patient. Specimen identification would have to do with specimens coming into the lab where they're unlabeled or mislabeled. A mislabeled specimen could be where the specimen itself is labeled with a chart label, but then the order that was pulled and the barcode that was applied next to it or over it, or somehow is it from a different patient, so there's a mix match there, and then you have to wonder which one's the right one. Okay, order entry has to do with the right test being ordered on the right patient at the right time, right? So one, ordering it on the right patient, not the wrong patient, but then ordering the right test. So there are some tests that are similar sounding. So for example, a hemoglobin and a hemoglobin A1C are not the same test. And then specimen integrity has to do with getting the right amount of specimen. So for the blood collections, a lot of times it involves, you know, the tube needs to be full. This could also involve, you know, losing a specimen or forgetting it, not storing it at the right temperature, etc. And then effective use of the clinical lab is going to be, again, ordering the right test in a timely manner on the patient so that we can help the patient and get the answers that they need. And then the analytical phase, so this is in the testing portion, is the biggest problem here would be to make sure we verify the accuracy of abnormal results. And so questions that you can ask there is when we review abnormal results is for one, is this compatible with life? does this match specimen presentation, patient presentation? Do they have a history of these types of abnormal results? Is there any problems with the machines? Was the quality control okay? Is everything working so that when we turn out abnormal results, they are indeed accurate? And then in the post-analytical phase, so this has to do from post-testing to, you know, the reporting of the results and then with follow-up action going on. So communication of test results, are the test results landing into the right chart? Are they coming across? Are they being reviewed by the nursing staff? If they were critical, were they called to the appropriate nursing staff and were they documented? And was action taken based on those results? The effective use of the test results has to do with, again, are we communicating this to the patient, and then are we using these test results to help guide care? And so, like, for example, having something a test result that came back positive on a patient and it not being communicated and acted on, that would be a problem. And then, of course, also in the effective use is going to be ordering the right test, and reporting the right test, and then understanding those test results. So this is a very important key here. Does the nurse understand what these test results mean? And in the outcomes of lab testing here, too, there's, not letting patients know that they have abnormal test results or not ordering the proper follow-up test based on those abnormal test results. And so those are really important. It's disconcerting for a patient to find out that, their tests were abnormal and nobody ever called them and talked to them and, consulted with them to let them know what the follow-up was going to be or what it actually meant. So, all right, so that wraps up a little bit on patient safety, and I hope you found that helpful, and more coming here in the next video.